So about a week ago, I was pretty excited and optimistic about testing the RTX 5090, but my enthusiasm was quickly dampened by two things. One, I encountered a bunch of troubles with my testing that I'm going to go over later in the video. Secondly, it became apparent pretty quickly that NVIDIA overpromised on the performance that the 5090 was going to be offering, and that is also echoed in the reviews that I'm going to be covering today. And then I suppose I could add a third and possibly most frustrating thing, and that is that even with the $2,000 MSRP of the RTX 5090, and reviewers like me saying, hold on, they're not providing you with as much value as was initially promised, these are going to sell out anyway. Today's video is brought to you by the Paul's Hardware store on paulshardware.net, the only official source for Paul's Hardware merchandise. Tantalizing t-shirts, brilliant beer sets, high-quality hoodies, and more, all featuring the classic thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers, or the 8-bit thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers who hate curves. New designs are added sporadically and at random, so head over to paulshardware.net and get some of that sweet, sweet merch right now. Or not right now, after you watch the video. Either way. So because of those testing troubles that I mentioned, I'm not bringing you guys a full review today with my testing data. I'm instead going to be doing a review roundup with testing and conclusions from 6 different reviewers. Those are Hardware Unboxed, Gamers Nexus, Linus Tech Tips, Optimum, Der Bauer, and Jay's 2 Cents. The overall conclusion between all of these reviews was remarkably consistent. The RTX 5090 Founders Edition provides a reasonable 25-30% raw performance boost over the last generation RTX 4090, and it sports a genuinely well-designed 2-slot cooler. However, the performance uplift versus the 40 series is disappointing compared to the 30 to 40 series jump that we got last generation, and the value or performance per dollar, as well as the efficiency or performance per watts, remain disappointingly flat with the 5090. Balanced reviews have also struggled to address DLSS4 and multi-frame generation features, as MFG in particular was heavily marketed by NVIDIA as FPS performance booster, when in fact, strictly speaking, it is not. I've put timestamps in the description if you guys want to jump to a specific point in this video, but we're going to start off with the good stuff about the RTX 5090, then we got a couple segments on the stuff that was not as good, and then finally a summary of my testing woes and a bit of a behind the scenes as to what it's like to try to test a new graphics card when things aren't going well. So the good things about the 5090 are the performance. It is definitely faster than last gen, and it's definitely now the fastest gaming graphics card on the market, and the cooling, specifically with this 2-slot cooler being able to keep up with a 575-watt TDP graphics card. Jumping straight to the summaries, Gamers Nexus, when testing at 4K, found a 20-50% uplift in raw rasterization performance for the 5090, that's depending on the title it was tested. When using ray tracing, the performance increase was 27-35%. Hardware Unboxed found similar rasterization results at 4K, about a 27% uplift versus the 4090. At 1440, the uplift was definitely less, down to 12%, and if you bring it down to 1080, where many games are CPU bound, the uplift is only minimal or perhaps 1%. Optimum, meanwhile, found a 27% uplift when testing at 4K. Linus Tech Tips, who notably tested with the 7800X3D, found an 18% uplift at 1440p and a 28% uplift at 4K. Jay from Jay's 2 Cents has upgraded his testing methodology and he found slightly more favorable results, 32.4% faster at 4K. And then Der Bauer's RTX 5090 came in 26% faster than the 4090, also at 4K, but that is also with a 35% increased power draw. And that's going to be part of the bad side of things, but to sum up the good things, yes, it's now the fastest gaming graphics card ever, but you're definitely not going to get as much value out of a 5090 if you're not gaming at 4K, ideally with a higher refresh rate like 240Hz. The second very good and positive thing about the RTX 5090, Founders Edition in particular, is this cooler, the 2-slot vapor chamber cooler with 2 pass-through fans, a unique cooling design and definitely an effective one per the testing. GPU temperatures, as reported by these reviews, are typically in the low 70s, during extensive game testing, maybe 73-74C, and then if you use the Fermark test, which is a GPU stress test which goes far beyond what any actual game would do, it only pushes up the temperatures into the high 70s, maybe around 78 degrees Celsius. And then Jay said he also popped the 5090 Founders Edition into a small form factor build, and the temps only increased by about 2 degrees to 80 degrees Celsius. So clearly, given the amount of heat that this cart outputs, because having a smaller cooler doesn't mean it outputs less heat, it just means that the cooler is pushing that heat away from the GPU and into your room where you're gaming more efficiently. But NVIDIA undoubtedly did a good job with the design of this cooler. It's also worth noting if you're testing in FermArc, your GPU is going to run at a lower frequency. As Jay demonstrated in his testing, that is a synthetic test, however. Gamers Nexus did their Schlieren testing, which provides an excellent visual of the heat actually escaping from the Founders Edition cooler and being pushed away from the fan intakes to prevent recirculation of that hot air. If there's a downside to the cooler, it's probably the memory temperatures. They're not bad, but they're not fantastic. The VRAM can get up to about 88 degrees Celsius, which is not ideal, but still well within the range of functionality. Okay, let's move on to the negative stuff, the criticisms of the 5090 and how it is marketed, and I've put these into two different categories, starting with relative performance and cost per frame. But wait, I already said the performance is good. It's good because it's better than last generation, but it is not good relative to the performance uplift that we have come to expect with a new generation of graphics cards, particularly when NVIDIA has had more than 2 years to get the 50 series sorted out. For one, the Blackwell GPUs that power the 5090 and the 50 series are still built on TSMC's 4N process, which is the same process that was used by the 40 series. A process node shrink can often lead to better performance and better efficiency, but we didn't get that this time around, so all we are really relying on is improvements to the Blackwell architecture and then changes to stuff like the die size, and the 5090 definitely has a much larger die and more than 20,000 CUDA cores. Now, in my opinion, and I've been covering PC hardware for quite some time, new GPUs, next-gen GPUs, should either significantly improve the performance per dollar, or if they can't do that, then they should at least greatly improve efficiency or performance per watt. But it seems like NVIDIA is going the RTX 20 series route this time around. The 5090 does not provide improved performance per dollar, neither does it greatly improve efficiency. You get 25 to 30% more performance versus last generation, but it also comes in at a price that's 25 to 33% higher, depending on how you do that math, as well as a similar increase to power draw. I thought Optimum did a really good job at showing this by comparing the uplift we got with the 3090 to the 4090, and then immediately following that up with comparisons of the 4090 to the 5090. Jumping from the 3090 to the 4090 got you a 74% boost in performance while drawing a similar amount of power, and the price only went from $1,500 to $1,600. That's not including the 3090 Ti that launched a little bit later, that was selling for $2,000. Meanwhile, the 4090 to 5090 jump shows a 27% performance boost, but often draws 50 to 150 watts more power and is 33% more expensive. This is also shown in Hardware Unboxed's cost per frame charts. $14.59 per frame with the 5090 versus $14.81 for the 4090. That bar has not moved at all in 2+ years. What has NVIDIA done in the past couple years, eh? I think they've made a fair amount of money. But let's not speculate on that too much. The second bad part about the 5090 is NVIDIA's reliance on DLSS4 and specifically frame generation to sell the card and to advertise the card pre-launch before reviewers could come out with actual third-party numbers. And I've said this before to some controversy, but MFG or multi-frame generation is not inherently bad, but it's not free frames. It is frame smoothing. That is good for single-player titles playing at 4K with higher refresh rates. It is bad for fast-paced competitive gaming or any type of game where input lag is a concern. Input lag is bad, and reducing that as much as possible is a good thing, which NVIDIA has also done with its Reflex technology, which they tout a lot. But somehow, the input lag and latency argument goes out the door when they bring multi-frame generation into play and they want to just show charts with higher FPS values. Now, some of the reviewers opted to take DLSS and multi-frame generation out of their reviews completely and cover them in a separate content piece, but DeBauer pointed out one issue that can happen with multi-frame generation. When testing Star Wars Outlaws, he encountered a fair amount of issues with artifacts and glitches. And this wasn't just like move the camera really fast and freeze frame and you can see some jagged edges. These were like pawns with like lily pads that were disappearing and reappearing and stuff like that. Now that's probably something that could be improved or fixed with a driver update in the future, but it just goes to show that not all generated frames are equivalent to game engine frames. They're also not going to include new information from the game engine, which is very important if you're playing a fast-paced title. On a quick side note, DeBauer also had a lot of coil whine with his RTX 5090, and that game wasn't running at a super high frame rate or anything like that, so just something to consider. Ollie over at Optimum, I think, did the most fair and balanced launch day assessments of MFG. He started out by simply running it at 4K 240Hz with ray traced path tracing enabled, which is very GPU intensive and can often kill your frame rate. His assessment was not universally bad. He actually found the gameplay experience at 4K 240 hertz with all that eye candy turned on to be quite good, and in order to achieve a similar frame rate with MFG turned off, he had to turn the game's visual settings way down, which significantly impacted the overall look of the game. But even with that overall positive response to the gaming experience, he was still able to slow things down and find visual glitches and artifacts that came from the generated frames, especially during fast-paced scenes or while driving around in Cyberpunk. Also, it's very clear that latency becomes an issue with these features turned on. Latency without DLSS and frame generation was about 13 milliseconds, but with that all enabled, it jumped up to 33 milliseconds. So I really wish Nvidia hadn't poisoned the discussion about frame generation so we could address its helpful and beneficial use cases without the false equivalency to frames rendered natively by the game engine. But hopefully all of the reviews that have been coming out are going to help educate people so everyone knows the difference. But jumping back to my personal experience, in the past week or so with the RTX 5090, it did not go smoothly. I want to point out that I'm sharing this as an anecdote. I talked to other reviewers as well as Nvidia directly, and my experience was definitely anomalous. Basically, I had 3 days to do all my testing that I had set aside where I was like, I'm going to be testing the RTX 5090 at this time. The first day mainly involved the hardware setup, getting my test bed actually assembled with the hardware I wanted to test with, also figuring out the software I was going to be using, wrangling the games and getting them all downloaded and updated, running system updates, making sure Windows is all the way up to date, making sure that all my settings are locked in, and then running some initial stability tests to make sure my test bed is stable before I start churning through the benchmarks. The motherboard I chose was the ASUS ROG Crosshair X870E Hero because I actually have two of these and I got two 9800X3Ds and I wanted to set up dual test beds so I could run even more benchmarks. However, as I was going through the setup of test bed number one, I started to encounter weird stability issues. Black screens where I couldn't get the system to display anything on the screen unless I restarted it. Weird stutters and stuff like that. Oftentimes with a new test bed setup, stability issues like that will start to go away as you get drivers up to date and your BIOS and Windows and everything. However, as I started to do initial stability tests, it became pretty apparent to me that this test bed was just remarkably unstable. So as I moved into day two, I started to get a second test bed setup because I really didn't have the time to go through all the troubleshooting to figure out what was going wrong with this one. For my second test bed, I used this motherboard, the Gigabyte X870E Aorus Master, and thankfully the stability issues seemed to clear up pretty quickly. And I should note that I was using pretty much all different hardware, except for the memory kit that I carried over from the initial system. I had a different power supply, I had a different 9800X3D. I did a clean installation of Windows 11 again, went through all the system setup steps, and then started some initial tests again to determine if my system was stable, and I almost immediately started to get crashes, specifically with Shadow of the Tomb Raider. That made me think, oh no, something's still wrong. I had Cyberpunk 2077 also crash when I just was trying to load the game. It's crazy how when you're in a time-limited scenario like that and you have a deadline approaching, how the time in a day can just disappear, especially as you're going through a bunch of different troubleshooting steps, trying stuff like switching over to the 4090 to try a different graphics card, swapping the memory kit out, trying various Windows settings. I wish I had made a list of everything that I did. It kind of went by in a blur. I did two full system do-overs with a clean and fresh Windows 11 installation, and I also started to reach out to Nvidia to be like, hey, I'm not sure if it's my fault or not, but I'm definitely having some issues with testing, and they thankfully followed up pretty quickly and helped me out with the troubleshooting process. The most consistent, repeatable issue was with Shadow of the Tomb Raider running the built-in benchmark between the first and second scene is when the crash would occur. Sometimes it would just crash to the desktop, sometimes it would crash to the desktop and I would get an actual error box that told me a DirectX device had hung. But because I had spent a couple days troubleshooting and not actually running benchmarks that I could present to you guys, I was starting to get a little bit frazzled and a little bit frustrated and starting to have to think about what am I going to do if I can't actually do like a standard benchmarking video. The answer is this video right here. Thankfully, on day three, towards the end of the day, I finally figured out the issue. And I figured it out by switching to the RTX 4090 just after a driver wipe with display driver uninstaller. When it booted back into Windows, Windows Update automatically installed an older driver, the default driver that Windows Update will install for a recognized GPU like the RTX 4090. That driver was version 560.94, and I was like, why don't I just try one with the old driver? And it did fine. I got past that crash point, no problem. So it appears that what happened is very early on in my testing, I discovered a driver bug that specifically affects Shadow of the Tomb Raider. Again, probably something that could be fixed by NVIDIA's driver team. They are aware of it now. But that got me hung up on an issue that I had something wrong with my test bed or possibly even a defective RTX 5090. That wasn't the case. My 5090 seems to be just fine, but it did burn up all of my benchmarking time, which is why I don't have any benchmarks to share with you guys right now. But I do have another week before there is another debut of another graphics card, the RTX 5080. I also have some alternative models, add-in board partner cards for the RTX 1590 that I'm gonna be testing. So I'm gonna get back to it now that I've gotten past that issue. I wanna say a huge thank you to all the reviewers who did the excellent reviews that are linked in the video's description. And I highly recommend you check those out because all of them are different in some ways. And I think that's the great benefit that you guys get from having so many different reviewers out there. Everyone's gonna test things a little bit differently. And even if one reviewer has a little bit of an issue and isn't able to get something out, you're gonna have lots of other options to choose from. So again, check those videos out if you haven't already. They're all linked in the video's description. And if you guys have any feedback for me on the RTX 5090 Founders Edition, leave that in the comment section down below because I'd love to hear your feedback now that you've gotten some more straight information on the actual performance of this card, especially for $2,000. Is it gonna stay $2,000? Are these actually not gonna sell well because people have finally had it and NVIDIA went too far with the pricing? I'm not so sure about that, but we will see next week. Thank you guys again for watching this video. Hit the thumbs up button if you enjoyed it. Check out my store at paulshardware.net where you can find shirts, mugs, pint glasses, and more high quality merchandise to help support my channel. We'll see you all in the next video.